Schönen guten Abend, dear friends. A warm welcome to the online event by Goethe-Zentrum Hyderabad. Most of you are aware, we are a cultural and German language institute situated in Hyderabad. All our German classes, except for one or two recently started physical ones, have been digital since the onset of the pandemic. Our cultural events have also gone digital. We have been able to stream music concerts, virtual exhibitions, of course, panels such as this. Please check out our social media handles and Goethe-Zentrum Hyderabad website, and my colleague will post it in the chat box here. Today's event is a part of Women's March, hosted by Goethe-Zentrum Hyderabad close to 15 years. We commemorate and celebrate women as well as an institution, participate actively in the gender discourse. Today's session, Why Loiter? Women and Risk on Mumbai Streets, based on the book written by Shilpa Phadke, Samira Khan, Shilpa Ranade, published in 2011, we'll explore women and the city. Why loitering should matter even to those who are not feminists. What has happened in the last decade? Where are we? Are we anywhere close to the vision of the authors and others? And I read from the flap of the book written 10 years ago. Imagine our streets full of women, talking, strolling, laughing, and gesticulating. Imagine parks and beaches dotted with young women sitting alone. Imagine street corners taken over by older women reflecting on the state of the world. Imagine maidans occupied by women workers planning the next strike for a raise in minimum wages. If you can imagine all of this, one can imagine a radically altered city. In their book, Shilpa Phadke, Samira Khan, and Shilpa Ranade argue that we need to redefine, and I'm quoting, our understanding of violence in relation to public space, to see not only sexual assault, but the denial of access to public space as the worst possible outcome for women. In conversation with authors will be the senior journalist, Kalpana Sharma. I'm privileged to briefly introduce all four power ladies here on the screen and hand over the session to them. Shilpa Phadke is a professor at the School of Media and Cultural Studies, Tata Institute of Social Sciences in Mumbai. She's co-director of the documentary Under the Open Sky, which came out in 2017. She has published widely, both academically and in popular media. Her area of interest include cities and public spaces, middle-class sexuality, practices of consumption, feminist pedagogy, feminist mothering, young women's relationship with feminism, and online public spaces. Samira Khan is a Mumbai-based independent journalist, researcher, and writer. A journalist for three decades and a former assistant editor with the Times of India, she has taught courses of journalism at the Tata Institute of Social Sciences. Till recently, she wrote a column Streetwise on women and the city in The Hindu. For the last decade, she has also been a media trainer, guiding journalists on how to cover violence against women, particularly rape. Shilpa Ranade is a practicing architect and researcher. She's a founding partner of the award-winning design firm DCOOP, where her portfolio includes master planning, housing, institutional and interior design, and product design projects. She has also been associate editor of the South Asia volume of the book, World Architecture, 1900 to 2000, a critical mosaic brought out by the Springer Verlag in Vienna in 2000. Shilpa is a visiting faculty at the Kamala Raheja Vidyanidhi Institute of Architecture in Mumbai. Kalpana Sharma is an independent journalist, columnist, and author based in Mumbai. In almost five decades as a journalist, specializing in developmental, environmental, and gender issues, she has worked with Himmat Weekly, Indian Express, Times of India, and The Hindu. She was consulting editor with the Economic and Political Weekly and readers as editor with Scroll. Her column on gender, The Other Half, ran for 30 years, first in the Indian Express and then The Hindu. Currently, she writes a media column in newslaundry.com. Her latest book is The Silence and the Storm, Narratives of Violence Against Women, which came out in 2019. She's also the author of Rediscovering Dharavi, Stories from Asia's Largest Slum. In addition, she has edited Single by Choice, Happily Unmarried Women. The format of the panel today is that Kalpana Sharma will lead the discourse, followed by questions that you may add, please, in your chat box, wherever you have logged in. And we will, and my colleagues, Jyoti Biswada and Satyendra Pal, will pass these questions on to Kalpana to raise them to our panelists. I look forward to a very meaningful evening. Thank you so much, everyone, for being here. And thank you, Kalpana, Shilpa, Shilpa, and Samira.
Thank you, Amita, for this introduction. And hello, everybody. And hello to the two Shilpas and Samira. I'm very happy to be here. To have this discussion on a book which, I'll hold it up. If you haven't already bought it or read it, please go now and look on whatever website you buy these books from, or if there's a favorite independent bookshop that you can find, and read it, because, you know, it's 10 years old, but in my mind, it's an evergreen book because it was pathbreaking in what it tried to do. But I think it's one of those books that remains relevant to the times in which we live. And I think it's well worth getting hold of it and reading. This evening, as part of the conversation, I will let the authors themselves talk about why they wrote the book and how they conducted this study. But let me just say that I found, when I first read it, which was in 2011, I found it innovative, and it gave many new insights into many things that we take for granted. Even those of us who've written on gender take a lot of these things for granted. And indeed, when I wrote my last book, The Silence and the Storm, on the issue of violence against women, I turned to Y. Leuter, because it gave me the kind of simple way of explaining something about public space and women, which I could not locate elsewhere. And now when we read it a decade later, as I said, a lot of it is relevant, but it's also against the background that the structures of patriarchy in India remain virtually untouched. You know, in this decade, nothing much has changed in that sense. And I would say, in fact, it's become a harder challenge because they've taken on new avatars, you know. So on the surface, it seems diffused, but actually when you come to it and when you read what is happening, it's far more embedded. And that, for me, makes it even more relevant. So from my reading of the book, of course, everybody will always, with a book like this, take away different things. But let me just spell out the three things that I think the book has brought out. One is the question of risk and safety, which is the subtitle of the book. And let's remember that this book was published in 2011, a whole year before the 2012 gang rape in Delhi. You know, and after that, it triggered off much more of a conversation in the media, amongst people, on the whole issue of risk and safety for women in the public space, the issue of public transport, etc. 6 months after that, we who live in Mumbai, which in any case we think of as a much safer city than most other cities in India, had the incidents of the Shakti Mills gang rape, where a woman photojournalist was raped while on assignment in a place which is like in the center of Mumbai, walking distance from the railway station, not a, you know, somewhere out in the boondocks. It was right there in the middle of Bombay. And I think it was a shock, and it made you think that these are not conversations that you can just have and complete. They are ongoing conversations. And so the question we can ask, I think, after a decade is, did the conversations that were triggered then actually lead to any change? The other thing that I think it brings out is this whole access to public space and women's right to access public space. So what is sectioned off? What is available? The key word is public, you know? So are women part of that public? And are cities providing more democratic, safe public spaces that women can access? Or is the direction of urban development today going actually against this trend? I think we have to ask it because it has a relevance to the whole issue of women in the public space. One of the surprising findings I found in your study was that in the privatized public space of the shopping mall, women were actually finding that this was a space that they could access, and it gave them, I found it quite a contradiction in terms, in a sense, that here was a privatized space, and yet because of the lack of these kinds of spaces, this became a space where women felt really free, at least one class of women. The third and most important question, I think, is the one you bring out about pleasure. And that connects to the use of the word loiter, you know, and loitering. It has always had a negative connotation in India. You know, men loiter, but women should not, you know, and they do not. Somehow it's wrong for women to loiter, you know, just hang about, just go for a walk for the sake of it, you know. You have to have a purpose why you step out. And why should it be considered joyful to just hang about doing nothing? So that's the other thing to consider. In the 10 years, has that changed? You know, has there been a generational shift with young women now feeling, claiming that as a right, the right to loiter? Has technology played a part in that? So those are just some of the broad things that I lay out. We'll go into more detail. And what I'd like to do is ask each of you one aspect of you know, the issues that you brought out in your study. And then maybe we can have a general conversation on some of the other things that will come up. So let me start with you, Samira. I'd like you to speak about on why you did this study, first of all, and what you feel are some of its important findings, apart from what I mentioned. I'm sure there are others. Always remembering that it was done in Bombay, Mumbai, you know, which, as I said, is something of an outlier even amongst metros. And just to put this in some perspective, last week, Sonaldi Desai wrote a very interesting piece in op-ed in the Indian Express, where she gave some statistics from the Human Development Survey of 2012. That is a year after you'd done the book. It was just conducted by the University of Maryland and the National Council of Applied Economic Research. And it, I mean, what it revealed, it should not come as a surprise to you, but I think to many others, that 18% of women respondents do not go to a kirana shop. Now, that is something we would think that, you know, women do. A further 19% would not go alone. A third of households relied only on men or children to do any grocery shopping. And as far as rural India is concerned, only 11% of rural women had ever attended a Gram Sabha. Barely 18% had ever visited a metropolitan city, and an equal portion had ventured outside their state, you know. So this was then, and I don't think now in 2021 that the data would be all that different. So Samira, against that, will you talk about, you know, why did you feel you had to study this? So many things about women are studied. Why this?
Yeah. Okay, so one of the reasons, you know, of course, we were, all three of us were based in Bombay, so Bombay became the site of study. So the book came about as a result of a research project, which we did, a three-year research project set in Bombay. But a lot of the some things are very particular to Bombay and to Mumbai, but some were not. Some are just, I think, could be applied to any other South Asian city in that sense. But we were curious to find that if Bombay, as you said, or Mumbai, is the city which is relatively most friendly to Indian women, then what is that friendliness based on? Why is Mumbai found so accessible? Why do women always talk about Bombay, always talk about Mumbai so appreciatively always. So what if they offer, if Mumbai offers unparalleled access to public spaces to Mumbai, to women, then what type of access is it and what is it facilitated? What is the context, history, whatever? So we looked at that. So in fact, our first chapter is called Why Mumbai, why we're looking at that. And if we could find a particular standard, if Mumbai was a standard bearer of women's access, what was the standard and could we then, sort of replicate in other cities? Why couldn't it be replicated? And so besides looking at issues of how women access public space, issues of attitude, design, public infrastructure, safety, comfort, all kinds of things. Are they out for work, for functional purposes, or out for fun? We also looked at, material design, public space in a great way, which I think Shilpa Ranade can talk about later. But so Bombay became that thing. But the study showed already in the mid-2000s, when we did our study, that Bombay anyway was changing and Mumbai was changing. The city was not the way we had always thought of in our imagination. Things had changed in the way it functioned as a city in terms of its manufacturing base had changed. It became a service center, financial center. So lots of things in the way the city operated had changed. The pressure on public infrastructure, the pressure on public transport, which is one of the big reasons why women could commute long distances, already was showing in the mid-2000s. And our research showed that at any given point of time in Mumbai, any women would constitute very little percentage of the public. We saw maximum at any particular point of time public space, you saw less than 20% of the total population of that public space would be women at any given point of time, even in a city, relatively friendlier city like Mumbai. Our research showed us things which, when you ask, is it relevant 10 years later, we think, yes, it's still relevant. It talked about that when women did access public space, they use multiple strategies to access it. If they've been doing it for a long time, most of them wore it like second skin. They didn't realize they were strategizing to access it in many ways. It could be the kind of timings they kept, or who they accompanied, or what they wore, what they carried. In different ways, they were showing, they were trying to strategize in order to access. Or even, for example, we discovered the cell phone, which was already starting to be used as a device to protect yourself in public space, whether it was actually on, you were talking to someone, or you were not even talking to someone. So as you mentioned earlier, that they had to demonstrate purpose. You had to be, even in a city like Mumbai, you had to be out and demonstrate purpose. Why are you out there? You're picking up your children from school, you're picking up groceries, you're going to work, you're going to school, you're going to college. This hanging out made most women uncomfortable. If you said, were you just hanging out? And that was not done. It had to be a functional purpose. The other thing is they had to constantly manufacture respectability for themselves when they're out. When they're out of the private space into public space, constantly prove that we are good women, worthy of protection. And again, this was, this respectability was worn in different garb through the different strategies you use. And it seemed that more than actual safety, it was very important for women to always protect their reputations rather than produce actual safety for themselves. I'm going to give an example. We found that many areas, women would say that at night, if they're being dropped off by whether a male colleague or a male friend, they would get off a little distance away from where they actually lived. Even if that place was couched in darkness, it would have made more sense if someone's dropping you to drop you really at your gate. But many women said that they didn't mind then running those steps to their lane or to their house, as long as someone didn't view some male person dropping them. And this was more important than their actual physical safety. And we found this very often. Women would talk about more than, I think their family and community would talk about actual physical safety. But women themselves talk about protecting reputation. So I shouldn't be seen by being dropped late at night by a male colleague or a male friend or whatever. Even though I'm feeling insecure, I'm feeling I could be assaulted, I will run those steps. I will do something. I will strategize in some way to reach my door. But I don't want someone seeing that. So this protecting my reputation of my family, that all rests on, particularly for young women, this rests on our bodies. Like our bodies are, it's very important. Some other little observation we found, like if women lived in homogeneous neighborhoods, which were peopled by people of their own community or class or whatever, they seemed more policed than if they lived in heterogeneous neighborhoods or mixed neighborhoods with different communities, different class composition. That sort of gave women more mobility in that sense. They could negotiate much more easily those boundaries. So these are just some of the things that I think later if you talk about, there's a whole section on urban design we talk about. Maybe Shilpa Ranade can talk about that. So these are some of the findings we found. And I don't think anything is majorly changed in that sense. I think women constantly are doing this and strategizing. So it's not that they don't access public space because you paint it out to be a dangerous space. They access it in all kinds of ways, what is possible, what they can negotiate.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks. I think, you know, I think your point about this manufacturing respectability is a very important one that still holds. And I think the other thing is always having to have a purpose. You know, I mean, I think even in these COVID times, I was just, when we were discussing this earlier, I find it so inbuilt in you that, you know, you go out for a walk, you know, because it's exercise. Or you go out because you have some errand to do. But you can't just go out because you feel like going out. You're feeling goofed up and you want to go out. And that's the internalized thing that, you know, many women, I don't know about younger women, but certainly women of my age still internalize that. There has to be a purpose for going out. And I think that last point about the homogenous neighborhoods is also a very interesting thing, because again, in a city like Mumbai, we've always had these kind of, many of these mixed neighborhoods, but there are also other smaller enclaves which are homogenous. So this thing of being watched and being policed, and especially for younger women, I think that is a very important criteria. Shilpa Phadke, I'd like to go now to the whole issue of risk and safety. And, you know, for a person of my generation, certainly this has been a discussion from the 1980s. I mean, I can remember at that time I was working with the Indian Express, and we covered the women's marching through, women who are marching through the city carrying placards saying "Take back the night," which was a way of again demonstrating that, you know, why should women be so afraid? And that again in a city like Mumbai. And in the last years, you know, Safety Pin, for instance, and Kalpana Vishwanath and others have done this whole work on public transport. I can remember attending a meeting where an international meeting where this thing was such a important thing. I mean, in Montreal, women had campaigned so that buses could stop wherever women wanted them to stop so that they could get off to the nearest point. And this was something they had to campaign with the city authorities because of the whole thing of women in safety. I think of Blank Noise and, you know, the kind of things that group has done of women going out and sleeping in parks and, you know, once again, drawing attention and also carrying the clothes that they normally wear and drawing attention to the fact that it had nothing to do with what you wore when you were sexually assaulted. This is all in terms of public spaces. You yourselves, all three of you, with the sort of programs that you launched as part of Why Loiter, you had all these women who were loitering around at night, you know, and you posted and used social media to bring it in. So the thing I want to ask you is, with hindsight, how effective do you think all this kind of thing has been, given that much of it is done really on a small scale, and in terms of the larger canvas of trying to change policies, is it having an impact? And the other thing is, you know, much of it is in metros, which again, for whatever reason, are still considered the safer spaces. But what about, you know, smaller towns, non-metros? This Sonali Desai's article published a study carried out by Safety Pin in Bhopal, Gwalior, and Jodhpur. And it found, I shouldn't be surprised, that 95% of women feel unsafe using public transport in these three cities. 89% feel unsafe in the marketplace, which again comes as a surprise because you would think that's a crowded area and why should you feel unsafe? 84% feel unsafe waiting for public transport, while 76% feel unsafe on roads or footpaths. So, you know, I think there's a huge contrast between metros and non-metros. So I want you to reflect on this whole issue of risk and safety from the perspective that you have gained from doing the study. And what do you think has changed and how do you think it needs to change, you know, and or how much has remained the same?
Right. Thanks so much, Kalpana. And also thanks so much to the Goethe Zentrum Center who's invited us. And I do want to say that they are among the few people who invited us when the book was released and remembered now that it was 10 years. They actually wrote to us saying it's 10 years. So we're really delighted to be doing this. Kalpana, thanks so much for that very thoughtful and sort of comprehensive question. In one sense, one of the things we tried very hard to do was to engage with what we call the discourse of safety, which is to argue that really the discourse of safety did not give women access to public space. That in fact, what it offered was a kind of conditional protection, a protection which was conditional, as Samira pointed out and you flagged, on women being respectable, on women having a purpose in public space. And so one of the things we tried very hard to do in the book, and I think in many ways we did it successfully, was to make a case that what women need to access public space is not conditional safety, but really the right to take risks, which is not that one should never be assaulted in public space, because we argued that no space is safe, even the home. In fact, the home is the most unsafe space, right? And no one tells women not to be there. And similarly, cities are not safe spaces either. But should women desire to be there, no one should question our right to be there. So no one should say, why were you there? What were you doing? Whom were you with? When you're assaulted, various kind of medical legal processes should ensue, we argued. In terms of policy, and as you pointed out when you introduced the book, 1 year later, you had the gang rape and murder of Jyoti Pandey in Delhi. And that really brought the issue of safety into the national mainstream. And on the one hand, additional reportage and additional attention is always a good thing, but it also produces, as we pointed out already in the book, narratives of danger. This idea that the city or the town is ever more dangerous, particularly for women. And the kind of study that you show is that you quoted is an indicator of these perceptions, right? That people do feel the city is unsafe because there are also these narratives of danger. So on the one hand, I think that at the level of the feminist discourse, we have managed really to transform that discourse. And now, and in addition to risk, what we argued, and I'm saying this for people who are not familiar with the book, we argued that what women needed in order to unconditionally access public space was everyone else, including other marginal citizens, including those who might not be seen friendly to women, to also be able to unconditionally access public space. And we use the metaphor of loitering, and we use the idea of loitering to engage with this, to say that everybody should be able to loiter. We flagged a British colonial law that looked at that, sort of said that anyone who was loitering suspiciously between sunset and sunrise could be arrested or without a warrant, basically arrested on suspicion. So we use this to sort of say that loitering makes everybody uncomfortable, and also to speak to what Amita said at the beginning, this idea that why loitering should matter even to those who are not feminists, because loitering speaks centrally to the question, who is a citizen? Whom does the city belong to? It also disrupts the neoliberal productivity of the city, right? Bombay's global claims is something we were looking at. And when you're loitering, you're producing literally nothing. And there's this kind of urge, very much so, and I'm sure Kalpana, you'll agree, that this was, I mean, it was not the case in the 80s when I was in school, or in the 90s when I was in college, that everything had to, that consuming was never productive, right? Now, when you consume, you're sort of quote unquote fueling the global economy. And this is something that's very post globalization. It's a very new. And so what loitering does is it disrupts this idea. I mean, at the most, you're drinking cutting chai. To respond to the policy question, at one level, I think that policies are responding to safety. And you see all of these apps. So there are also private apps. You have, as you pointed out, Safety Pin. You have Map, and Blank Noise, of course, has been doing this as long as we have. They started in 2003, about the same time that we began our research project. But since since 2011 and 12, you've also had many, many more NGOs engaging with this. You have tiny groups. You have, as you pointed out, the Vi Loiter gang who read our book and began to loiter. So at one level, there's a kind of feminist response to it where we've noticed that loitering as a word has become part of the feminist lexicon of access to public space. So even people who haven't read our book will talk about loitering. In terms of the policy response, if you look at municipal corporations, if you look at other kinds of policy bodies, they are still stuck on safety. And in some ways, it's in a benevolent way. So it's entered, say, the development plan of Bombay. So the gender is in the development plan. Safety issues are on the development plan. At one level, it's great. They're talking about lighting. There's some talk of public transport, but there's also simultaneously the neoliberal push to defund public transport. So the BEST buses, for instance, in Bombay are being increasingly defunded. There's talk of privatizing them. And really, we will argue that nothing could be worse than privatizing them. You know, for instance, one of the things we noticed after the gang rape and murder in 2012 is that, for instance, this took place on a private Blue Line bus. Now, this is something that could never happen on a BEST bus for the simple reason that you cannot take a BEST bus for a joyride. It is a public service facility. The other thing is it's not supposed to make profit. So, I mean, this is something that we need to continuously underscore. There are also, I think, downsides to it as if we look at the statement made by the Chief Minister of Madhya Pradesh saying that women should report to police stations before they venture out. So now this is couched in some kind of vision of safety, but it is deeply, deeply unfeminist. It deeply undermines any kind of feminist claim to public space. So I'd say at the mainstream public policy state level, the discourse has, I would say, not shifted. In some ways, given the kind of statement that the Chief Minister of Madhya Pradesh made, it's become worse because it's promoting surveillance as the answer. But the feminist discourse is a thing of joy, I think. Really, it's something that's really, I mean, people have taken the idea of loitering and run with it in so many directions. I mean, for us, it's a thing of joy.
Yeah, thanks, Shilpa. I think, you know, I think this, the concept of why loiter, you know, I think that is something that has really caught on. And it's something that intrigued a lot of people, that why loiter, you know? And the whole issue of right as well as pleasure, whereas with safety and risk, and as you said, safety is always emphasized. In fact, I recall after 2012, there was an Andhra Pradesh politician who made this statement saying, you know, women are like parked cars. So as long as the car is parked in your building, there's no risk involved, you know, there can't be an accident, nothing can happen. And, you know, I mean, for politicians to say this and be quoted and not deny it either, it just shows you where as far as policy is concerned. So I think this thing of protecting women, and we know this, that again, after the Jyoti Singh rape, the whole thing was keep the women at home, especially young women, don't let them out. Rather than the other way around saying this has happened, what can we do to make sure that all young women can go out with confidence and do the things that they want to do? So this kind of knee-jerk reaction of always locking up the women in order to make things safe for them. And as you say, it's not as if the home is any safer. That discourse seems to go around in a loop, you know, over and over again. So I think that is something. And I would say this thing of who is a citizen. And I think that is a very crucial thing on many levels, not just for women, but, you know, for the urban poor in all our cities who are also not considered citizens. So when they say they're planning for citizens, it's only planning for a certain kind of citizen. And that is the reason why increasingly all our cities in India are becoming dysfunctional, actually, for everybody, except for a very small percentage of people, because we're running down to public transport. We are encouraging privatized transport. All infrastructure is being planned around the comfort of the few who can afford privatized transport rather than the comfort of the many who depend on affordable public transport. And that's for another discussion. But in a way, that segues into Shilpa Ranade, who's an architect. And so I want to ask you this whole question of access, you know, because you have interacted, I'm sure, with city planners also on this issue. But the odd thing is that even as people talk about this, we know that the neoliberal economy is actually pushing our cities into this concept of what is called the global city. And so even the spaces that were there are getting privatized, you know. So this talk about open spaces, for instance, they will always say, oh, of course there are, but these are within gated communities. So they're not actually open to public access. And for Bombay particularly, this has been a very strange thing because Mumbai is not a city that has evolved with these kind of privatized spaces. And yet increasingly, that seems to be the way things are going. And I know that you also did this kind of mapping exercise. I find that quite fascinating because quite often we have preconceived notions about the way women access public space. So how did you do this to actually explain both to yourselves and to others that in fact, this is the way women do or do not access? So maybe you can talk about both the mapping exercise and also your own concepts that you feel are important in terms of city planning and city development that will serve the purpose of women getting the access and the right to access public space and also thereby making the city actually a much better place for everybody. So Shilpa Ranade, over to you. I can't hear you, Shilpa.
Yes, Shilpa.
Can't hear you.
Not able to hear you.
You are unmuted, but...
Shilpa, could you please log out and come back? That would help. Yeah. Meanwhile, we can continue.
So till Shilpa comes back, so let me go back to something, Shilpa Phadke, that you spoke about. I want you to just explain a little more. For me, one of the things in the book that was something I'd never thought about was this whole aspect, as I said, of pleasure in accessing public space. So could you perhaps amplify on that? Because, you know, I, at that point, and even today, sometimes I wonder whether this is a generational thing, or did you find in your study that even older women thought that if they had access, they would be able to, it gave them a kind of pleasure, maybe guilty pleasure, but pleasure that they felt they had the right to.
Okay, I'll be very quick because I can see Shilpa's back.
Yeah.
So, in fact, when we looked at pleasure and we looked at fun in public space, we built a lot on existing work in sexuality, particularly the work of Carol Vance and the conference that she hosted in 1984 at Barnard College, Pleasure and Danger, where broadly they were arguing that if women wait to talk about pleasure until no women are victims of violence, we will literally wait forever. And so based on that, we began to argue that our struggle against violence, building on their work, our struggle against violence and our quest for fun or pleasure in the public are not mutually exclusive goals. In fact, we can simultaneously struggle against violence even as we seek pleasure in public space. So that's the kind of work we were building on. And I think when we started to talk about loitering, we did have a lot of feminist scholars, feminist activists say to us, but why would you want to loiter? Even good men don't loiter. And loitering was somehow seen as sort of low down on what Nivedita Menon has called the hierarchy of oppressions. And she, of course, was also talking about sexuality, you know, and she was talking about the women's movement that didn't want lesbians to march as lesbians in the women's march. They said, don't fracture the sisterhood, you know. And so I think loitering came even lower than sexuality on the hierarchy of oppression. But I think that since then, most people have changed their minds. But I'll stop there and let's see, hopefully Shilpa's speaker, mic is back.
Yeah, Shilpa Ranade, are you back?
Shilpa, can you try without earphones? That might help. Because can you increase your system volume and check, please?
Getting.
No. Okay.
Yeah, now can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I'm really sorry about this. I don't know. Okay, I'm not going to unmute myself. I'm not going to mute myself now because I think it's hard for me to come back. So sorry about that. So just to the Kalpana, so we did a mapping, like a detailed mapping of a few public spaces in Mumbai, where we actually kind of drew how men and women were using the space at different times of the day. You know, so that was one of the mapping exercises we did. So, and you know, because when we do the counts, and like Samira mentioned, even when you literally count, there are hardly, you know, the percentage of women is very little. But even that doesn't tell us the full picture, because how these women are using space, you know, actually, so where they are found, how they're moving about in space was a big revelation which mapping gave us. Because what it showed is that even there was like a Maidan, in a public Maidan, which was right next to a co-educational school where there were equal number of men and like boys and girls. But the Maidan was primarily used by boys all the time. So we have these different color coding where we have stationary people and moving people. So you find a lot of stationary men at all times of the day, right? But the stationary women, there are hardly any stationary women in the map. So you will find lots of women who are accessing public space. So it's like the main insight there was that women were using public space just to go from one private space to another, even if that was from between home and office or home and work. So you think there are women out there, but they're using it only as a transit. So public space is literally a transitional space. And mapping really helped us visualize that. We also did this mapping exercises in school where we had people kind of draw their mental maps. You know, so we gave them maps of a neighborhood and asked them to place where a certain groups of people would be found. So for example, where three teenage boys and three teenage girls would be found. And we normally found like the kind of responses we got were almost unanimous, where the girls were very close to the house. So they were right outside their, the building entrance, or they were on the terrace, or they were in the house, or just outside the gate and so on. While the boys could be found anywhere. You know, so the boys could literally kind of access space without being marked in a way. But women were always marked as to where they were. Or there was a young woman who was waiting for a friend and a young man who was waiting for a friend. And the woman would stand at the bus stop because she had to manufacture the sense of purpose, like what Shilpa and Samira have been saying. So I think that mapping was very revelatory. When it comes to the design of public spaces, the big tripping point is actually this idea of a neutral user. Because, you know, when we design public spaces, we don't know who we are designing for, in some sense. We don't have the specific user in mind. And what happens in this kind of a patriarchal system where the hegemonic, this thing is a male, it by default, this user becomes like a upper caste, upper class, able-bodied kind of young man, in a sense. So, and that can be seen at like various scales in the design. So if you take like a public toilet, you take a typical public toilet and you will have a section for urinals, which is open like 24/7, and there'll be like maybe 10 to 15 urinals in that place. And then you'll have a section for toilets, which you might have like about some of the, like one particular example I'm talking about near Churchgate Station. And there were three toilets for women, six toilets for men, in addition to two baths for men, right? And that section closed at 9 o'clock in the night. So this whole idea is that women just are not supposed to be out there after 9 o'clock in the night because that section is completely closed. The numbers are abysmal because obviously to provide for equality, actually, you need more number of toilets for women than for men because women need more time to use a toilet, not because they stand in front of the mirror, how it's imagined, but because they use the toilet. I mean, they squat to pee. They're menstruating. Many women are pregnant, they lactate. They're the ones who take children to the, you know, if their children are there, it's a woman who will take the child to the toilet in a sense. So for all these reasons, women need like many more toilets, but that is kind of far from there. And the design of toilets is also kind of designed quite like absent-mindedly, like a simple thing which we keep repeating is like a hook behind a toilet door or on the wall, because women carry things in bags, right? We don't carry things in pockets, which is a question by itself as to why women's clothes don't have pockets, but we carry things in bags. And to sit in a, like to go in a public toilet where normally, and we have Western toilets now, which are unhygienic for people to use, for women to use, you know, so you're hovering over the toilet seat with your bag around your neck. And I mean, many of us have gone through this whole gymnastics of that. So, basic thing like a toilet, parks, like you mentioned, increasingly, we're kind of, you know, fencing up our parks in this idea of making them kind of more safer and keeping out the undesirables. But our research showed clearly, and kind of demonstrating what many other planners and urban designers have said, is that keeping making a place desirable, you need to welcome in more and more desirable people rather than try and keep out. So if you, I don't know how many of you are familiar with the Oval Maidan and Shivaji Park in Mumbai. So the Oval Maidan is fenced and it's got these deep ends which women don't feel comfortable using. And it's closed at night. While as compared to that, you look at Shivaji Park, which doesn't have, it just has a low wall around it. You cannot close it, right? But it's far more friendlier. You find people like late into the night, all kinds of people use it, you know. Like even you find girls alone there at late into the night, or you know, groups of older people using it. So that, and even, and coming to public city planning in particular, because like you mentioned, with this idea of this global city, we've got this idea of kind of separating spaces and cleaning them up, you know. So you've got this whole residential neighborhood, and you've got the commercial neighborhood, you've got industrial neighborhood and all that. But we find, and this is again something which others have pointed out, is that mixed-use neighborhoods, like what Mumbai had earlier, you know, the one of the reasons actually we found Mumbai is safe, one of the safer cities, because it has a lot of mixed-use spaces. So things are open till late in the night, you know, there's activity on the street, there are eyes on the street. Now, women find it far more friendlier to use these kind of spaces. So when you look at Nariman Point, which is a commercial district, it is dead by 10 o'clock in the night. When you go to Chembur or near the stations, or any other district which are mixed-use neighborhood, they're active till very late in the night. Plus for women who kind of trip chain many times, you know, so they do multiple activities rather than just go to work and come back. They might go and drop off their child, or, you know, go and do some shopping on the way. Having a mixed-use neighborhood is far more friendlier in that sense also. So I think, you know, at various levels, kind of city planning is unfriendly to women in that sense. Yeah.
Yeah, thanks. I think you made some very important points. And I think this issue of transit, you know, is one of the very strong things that comes out in the book, that women feel they have to go from point A to point B, you know, that they can't just stop in the middle and say, okay, now I just want to chill for a little while, because all of them have to have this purpose. So the women that we see on the street in the public spaces are always women on the move for some particular reason. Sanitation, you know, I mean, this is like, I'm reading this book, which has recently come out, called Invisible Women by Caroline Perez. And, you know, I mean, whether it's in the West or anywhere, I think this whole issue of adequate toilets for women is like, it's almost a universal thing, because somehow it doesn't register. An additional thing that you brought out about, you know, the norm of for whom are these things being planned, it's always the male of a particular size. Again, in this book, a very interesting thing comes out in terms of safety in cars. So apparently all the safety planning that is done for cars in terms of the shape of the seat belt or whatever is done for this one normative male that is of a particular size and height. And the majority of women would not fit in, you know, and, you know, physiologically we are different. We have breasts. What about women who are pregnant? None of that has come into the planning for safety in cars. And as a result, in fact, apparently, the statistics show that many more women get injured despite these safety things. So I think this thing of integrating it very much into the mindset of all levels of planning is such an important part, so that it's not just safety and risk, but it's actually the way we conceive of cities. I also liked your point about trip chaining, because I think that's another thing that's we can all relate to, you know, that most women, again, don't go from point A to point B alone. That on the way to work or on the way home, you also try and fit in as much as you can, which is also linked, of course, to the fact that women have the primary responsibility of running the home, looking after the children. So all these additional things play out in the way women access and use these spaces. And finally, I think, you know, the trend about zoning and separating residential from commercial is really something that is completely going against any concept of providing safe and secure ways in which women can use the city. And the thing about Mumbai always was this mixed neighborhood. I mean, they still survive, many of them. But in the extended suburbs, you know, it's gone into this kind of global norms of zoning, which is a pity, and one has to figure out how we can upturn this. Before we go to questions, I have two other things that I just want to flag, one which I any of you can answer. One is, how has technology changed you know, these are concepts that you've talked about, especially now with mobile telephony and the internet and the fact that younger women particularly can access it, but any woman now, you know, because she has a cell phone, does she feel safer? How does it play out in terms of both safety, risk? Is it a double-edged sword, or does it really work in terms of, you know, favoring safety for women? So either of you or all three of you can pitch in here. Who'd like to go first? Samira?
Okay, yeah. No, so we found in our study that, you know, when often we ask women, we also did exercises with them, for example, when we did focus group discussions about what was in their bag they were carrying, which they could use as a weapon, whatever, you know, like, and we were thinking, and I think, me from my college days in the 80s and working early in the 90s, talking about from safety pins to knuckle dusters to umbrellas, which could be transformed to weapon. And I realized that actually what had really changed, nobody felt the need for all this so much, but they felt that the cell phone actually stood in for anything. So many women talked that, you know, they would, one is they would really talk to someone on the phone, like they would talk to someone at home waiting for them or a friend. They would actually have conversation, and because they're having conversation, it's engaged. So if someone attacks and they can start screaming on the phone because the live call. But many women also told us that they actually, sometimes there was no call and you pretended. The moment you felt a little uncomfortable, you put up the phone and you started pretending to talk. And many talked about early morning, they were catching up maybe some, you know, we talked to a bunch of women lawyers who talked about early morning flights to Delhi, and they would 4:30 a.m. in the cab alone. They felt little uncomfortable. One is, of course, they would text message of the number of the cab, this, that, to someone, you know, or they were in fake calling, and they would actually hold the phone and talk to someone and pretend and say loudly, "Ke ha, bhai saab ko le ja rahe hain, crossing this." So they use the cell phone multiple in many ways, in many different ways. Also, I mean, young women tell us the phone becomes, of course, the reason they can, if they have access to, you know, a very simple phone, if they go out and the family is concerned about you, the cell phone manages to get them a little more access, because they keep saying, "Yeah, I'm coming back. I'm coming. I'm 10 minutes away or half an hour away." You may not be half an hour away, but the point is that you keep talking to someone at home and reassuring them. So that, because they have that, they said, otherwise, if phone nahi hota, then they would call us home much earlier, you know, which is like when it falls dark. You can negotiate a little bit. So you can strategize a little bit for yourself. Using that kind of technology. The other thing is the technology, I'm not just a cell phone, but you know, the whole internet, using, you know, being online or using social media to connect to people. We found that, I mean, not so much the study, but more after the book, in the sense we thought that we were doing ideas like do hashtag why loiter when you're loitering in a place, tell us in a text or a poem or a words or a picture where you are, encourage. We thought those campaigns worked well because women were, like they're reporting to each other. Like we are here, we are a group of women, we're hanging out here. Some from Calcutta is posting, some from Delhi is posting, Delhi, Mumbai is posting. So they felt a lot of strength. They said, you know, sometimes I didn't feel like doing it, but when I saw other women doing it and posting about it, I felt that we could do it too. You know, maybe two of us could go out and do something. So they felt very enlightened. So using the internet to connect, not just within the country, but even, you know, internationally, we saw a lot of people, part of our hashtag Violator campaigns were quite successful. A lot of women said, okay, now I'm seeing other women posting, they're sitting at Tapri and drinking chai. Now I feel I can do it too. It gives me a little more strength. So there was a lot of, you know, sort of collaboration and sort of strength got from each other in that sense, using technology. There's also the other idea of, you know, what we call like loitering online, in the sense of being, you know, you're online and you're sort of also, you know, trying out new things. But of course, loitering online is, you know, we say that's like we're part of the journey, but obviously we're really saying about being in public space and reality. We don't want women only to be at their computers and their desks and not have access to real space. It eventually means really being in real space and time. So
either of the Shilpas, anything to add to this?
Very, very quickly to add to this whole production and manufacture safety, because we found that really women were pushed to manufacture safety for ourselves. And when we were arguing for risk, one of the things we said very clearly that women should not be forced to take risks not of their choosing. So that there should be 24/7 public transport, there should be, and for instance, the Delhi government has recently made buses free for women. They've promised to make metros also, but I don't think that has happened yet. And I...
You muted yourself.
I accidentally muted myself. And I think these are very important moves because they recognize women as people and citizens in public space. So I think we really need to push policymakers to have better street lighting, better public toilets, more public transport. And that to some extent, I think the ways in which ideologies are structured means that women will continue to use all kinds of tactics to access public space. But I think we do need to push for infrastructure, that we should not be materially producing safety for ourselves. I mean, this is something that really we must push much harder for.
Shilpa Ranade, anything to add?
No.
Okay, I have just one more thing before I open it up for questions. This is, again, basically to ask you this whole thing of whether you're seeing a change. And I say this because, you know, for me, 2019, the most striking thing about that was the Anti-Citizenship Amendment Act demonstrations and the way women took over public spaces. You know, not just Shaheen Bagh here in Mumbai, we had Mumbai Bagh. And so many others. And it was young women and old women, you know, with such confidence that they were out there. And now we're seeing it again with the farmers' protests. So something seems to have shifted in women feeling, you know, that hesitancy seems to have broken through. It may be the politics of this time that we live in, where the counter push to, you know, get women to behave themselves is so strong that now a lot of women are pushing against it. So how do you see it? I mean, because we have to locate this also within our political and economic context. We can't look at these issues apart from that. So I want also you a few to respond to this, that, I mean, the future, given that, you know, we are stuck in this kind of neoliberal model as far as infrastructure and the development of our cities is concerned, given that a lot of the discourse still is more about protecting women rather than giving them their rights. Do you think that these things are breaking through because of the fact that the push to push women back into some kind of space is making a lot of women who may not have thought about it actually pushing back and reclaiming those spaces?
Can I begin?
Yeah.
Okay, fine. Then I will go, yeah.
Yeah, I think that you're exactly right here, that there really has been in the last two decades, we've seen women claiming public space and particularly young women claiming public space. And we see in the protests, we see young women and old women, but we're also seeing that the state seems most threatened by the young women in these protests. So there's something there as well. And so you have young women claiming public space as citizens. And in the protests now in 2019 and in 2020, you see women claiming public space as citizens in protection or in protest, claiming citizenship itself. And I think it's really important that we locate this in within the broad framework of women as citizens and women making claims on behalf of other marginal citizens, right? So these are not claims they are making now only on behalf of themselves. They are making these claims on behalf of a much, much larger polity, a much, much larger population. So they are making claims to citizenship. And if you notice, the iconic images of the protests were always of women, whether it was Bilkis Dadi in Shaheen Bagh, who got named on a number of lists as among the 100 most important or most influential women of 2019, or whether it was Aisha Rana from Jamia, whose raised finger appeared in one image after another, right, in protection of her fellow student who was a man. And I think that it's really important that we look at these images and we look also at the for fallout of them, that the kind of anxiety it has produced has meant that a large number of young women have been arrested for their role in these citizenship acts. And there's a kind of anxiety about what young women are doing. And then the response is this kind, and we can't see them as separate. Like the response is that you will pass an ordinance saying who can marry whom and who can convert in order to marry whom. Okay, as they have done in UP or in the state of MP, you will say young women or women must register at police stations. And these are really linked, you know. So we do need to look at them. But I completely agree with you that to see women standing out there in protest, in a sense, is a culmination of women claiming the public in a variety of ways, I think, in the last two decades. And it also then counters any kind of critique which has said that young women claiming the public is a neoliberal individualistic act, right? Because the citizenship protests are really, as you pointed out, countering not just right-wing agendas, but they are also countering neoliberal policies. They are a collective claim to democracy and to citizenship. Samira?
Yeah, and that, just to continue what Shilpa is saying, and that's why that the fact that a sitting Chief Justice can say that women are kept at protest sites is so... I mean, it is so frustrating. It makes you so angry because of what, when you stay at a time when just Shaheen Bagh has got over, now the women farmers are sitting, that these are just appendage of men. The women cannot be farmers. The men are farmers. These are only wives and daughters. Not looking at women in their own right, making this kind of claim. I also want to go a little bit more. Yes, in the case of the Citizenship Act, I also want to point out that minority women, Muslim women came out. Older women, younger women, whether they were wearing hijab or not wearing hijab. And I think that this image, which the state is trying to tell us, a certain image of what a Muslim woman looks like, has been broken. There are all kinds of Muslim women, and they can be political, even wearing the hijab. And you know, they have a point of view, and they are saying they're not stooges necessarily standing in for the men, but they also have been really angry. If you listen to those voices, whether in Mumbai Bagh, Shaheen Bagh, or in Bangalore, Bilal Bagh, they were angry voices who were claiming citizenship. So I think it's not just women, but different kinds of women. And I think also what we're seeing also, like, for example, Dalit voices coming out, Dalit women voices coming out and speaking, whether they're speaking or through, through social media or through other ways, but the very angry rising voices saying that we need to be counted and talked about as well. So I can see that. Plus, I think even predate, if you look from the 2012 gang rape case, after that, I mean, there's a whole upsurge of a lot of college students, boys and girls on the streets demanding change. But even after that, if you looked at changes they've been doing on college campuses, whether it's Banaras Hindu University or universities in Delhi, where parts of the Pinja Tor campaign have talked about women's rights to access libraries late at night on university campuses, or women's hostels, why do they have curfew hours, which are different. A lot of women across campus in Kerala, in Hyderabad, all kinds of places on college campuses, but women have asked, why don't we have the same rights that our male students have in terms of accessing the campus at certain time? So they have been pushing the frontiers. Young women have been remarkable in this country. I think in the last decade, we've seen them just push, and against real authoritative forces. And I would agree with Shilpa in this, they're being attacked, they're being assaulted for that by the state, which is really worried and upset about all kinds of, whether Dalit women are speaking up, Muslim women are speaking up, generally all kinds of other women's categories are speaking up, Kashmiri women are speaking up. I think that these women are pushing against boundaries and say, we will not be quiet. We are speaking up online, but we're also speaking offline. We're also in occupying space. So for example, what happens in Srinagar, where those mothers who occupy a park regularly, used to occupy park, talking about their missing children, about the, so those kinds of voices, I think worry the state a lot, and we can see a big backlash against it. But this is part of this whole thing, claiming space. You have to see us, you have to see our bodies in space, and our protesting bodies. So, I mean, look, we talk about pleasure, and I thought this Chief Justice comment, why are women kept to protest sites? So we said the two P's, the protest and pleasure, women's bodies in public space for protest and pleasure, both.
Yeah, thank you. Shilpa, Ranali, anything to add?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, great. No, I think Shilpa, Samir have covered most of it. I just wanted to, when Amita read the back flap of our book and the last thing that said, imagine maidans occupied by women workers planning their next strike for a raise in minimum wages. I mean, it might not be bad, but it's been much more than that. And that's great to know that at least that part of the radical city imagination, we've reached there in a sense. So it's just... remember that we'd written that. So
good. So I think let's go to questions. I'm very glad that Samira raised Pinjra Tor. Actually, I should have mentioned Pinjra Tor in the beginning, because that's a remarkable group in the way they, and what I find remarkable about it also, that it's not in this male-centric way of movements where you have a head, a face. Pinjra Tor is diffuse. It is women who are coming out and demanding you know, equal rights. It started off, of course, with the whole thing of hospital timings, but it expanded to much more. And as you know, two of these women are in jail right now in Delhi and being charged with having, participated in the riots in Delhi. But to me, that's one of the more remarkable movements that have taken place in India in the last decade. So there are a number of interesting questions that have come up. One question which Shaila Shah has asked is, what part can men play to facilitate women's access to public spaces? And in a way, linked to that, I think, is another question which Gurpreet asks, which is there any Mumbai India-centric research on involvement of women in policymaking and its impact on access use of public spaces? And I say why it's connected is because I think the reality is it's, you know, this area of planning is very much dominated still by men. And I don't think there are enough women who can, or women who can bring in this kind of feminist perspective. But are there men who are actually sensitive? Who is there a way in which one can get them involved to think from the perspective of a woman when they look at the manner in which the cities are being planned? Shilpa, Ranade, I'd like you to go with that.
So yeah, I think, you know, one of the, like, when we do the exercises, one of the things that comes out is that for many men, they don't even think that, that, you know, the way women strategize to access public space, let's say, you know, it doesn't even occur to them in some way because they've never done it before in a way. And that's not something one you blame them for, but it, I think one of the ways would be to kind of have this communication, and you understand that women do have to, I mean, the women's access to public space is very, very different. And it's kind of, you know, it's kind of much more complex. And you know, we had to strategize in some sense to do that. And so I think that's when this thing in terms of plan, I think it is in terms of the conversation, there is a lot more conversation in the professional domains about gender. I mean, one example of that is that the Mumbai DP, which is one of the first ones to have a whole gender section to it, you know, to address gender in a way. But what happens there is that it still focuses on projects which can be demonstrated, you know, like the you know, the hostel for working women. Now that can be demonstrated as a project and it can be signed off on the, you know, whatever the development goals and so on. But the more nuanced understanding of like transit, like you mentioned, of how women use public space very differently from men. Right now, those things have to yet come in because those are at a more invisible level in policy, and they cannot be kind of sold in PR so easily in a way. So I think those need to come in, and I think there are many women who are bringing in it now. But I think as they become more mainstreamed in a sense, and not seen as something that we are just providing as a kind of favor to all these to the women, you know, where the central thing is still this neutral man, and we are just kind of providing for these others in a way, and realizing it that actually more than 50% people are not provided for in the way we plan our cities. You know, it's not just women, but many other marginal citizens, you know, the disabled and so on. So I think it's beginning, but it is still right now at a lip service level. But I mean, there is hope in the sense that there is at least acknowledgement of it in a way.
Yeah, thanks. I mean, there's another question that's sort of linked with this, which anybody could answer, from Urvi. She says, with regard to women in public spaces, is the familiar public, such as neighborhood corners, more dangerous than the unknown public, such as train stations and roads? Or is such a distinction overstated? Who will go with that?
I don't know.
Shilpa, Ranade? Ranade, yeah.
I could start and then you all can add, but I'm not very sure about whether it is actually dangerous, but like Samira mentioned before, it is definitely more uncomfortable. I mean, it can be more uncomfortable because of this whole discourse of purpose and respectability that women's access is limited by, you know, in a sense, like one example that we saw is that one girl who lived in a homogeneous neighborhood, you know, in a place where this was occupied more mainly by her community, upper class neighborhood in Mumbai, found that, so she told us that when she came back with her boyfriend, she was dropped at the end of her street, which was like a dark, narrow alley, and she had to walk down there alone, although she felt unsafe, because she would rather kind of go through that, then have the building watchman see her with her boyfriend and talk about it, and you know, kind of her reputation be affected by that. So in a sense, I think kind of the anonymity that these, you know, the larger, like the big cities give us or unknown spaces give us a different kind of access to women, which kind of known spaces don't do, you know, because of the kind of surveillance and the narrative of respectability involved around that. So
to sort of briefly continue from there, the it's the outside which is cast as dangerous. So the external public is seen as dangerous. The more familiar is not, but as Shilpa pointed out, the dangers are to reputation rather than to your physical safety. So it's not only the men who will stare or the men who will comment. It's also the neighborhood aunties who will talk about you. And that has its own other kind of layer of the ways in which women then have access. And also, if you're a good conforming woman, then it's still okay, the familiar spaces. But if you're transgressive, then those are the worst spaces for you, because the greatest kind of violence happens within your neighborhood then.
Yeah. No, so we saw it constantly. A lot of women would tell us, for example, if there was a chai ki tapri somewhere in the neighborhood they lived in, they would never access that. So the only, if you ever saw a woman at a chai ki tapri in a residential, she had to be from out of that neighborhood. So the only way they would access, they went to college. If there's a chai ki tapri near college and there's a group of girls went even alone, so because you were going to college regularly, you've been going for 5 years, you won't access even that alone, the chai ki tapri. Same way, women who smoked talked about buying the from the pan bidi shop, not near neighborhood where they knew people or where they lived. They would buy, that they would send someone else to buy for them, maybe another male friend. But they could buy cigarettes from a pan bidi shop, which is very enough remote area. Same way, if you look at people when they sit, you know, the couples who sit on park benches, whether in central Bombay, whether it's Five Guns or in a bandstand. Very interesting. So when people talk about the couples in the neighborhood, they are never really from that neighborhood. They're always actually literally 8 stations away. You know, Bombay would be counted by 8 stations away or 10 stations away. So the ones from the neighborhood will never be seen there. So if you are from that neighborhood, you will be sitting with your boyfriend somewhere else, and someone else from another neighborhood is sitting here. So that is because you have this community policing. Someone is going to see me in my and report home. And even if my own family is okay with it, it's everybody at the kuspus goes on in the neighborhood. So this respectability thing is a big important thing. So you have to not just remain physically safe, but you also have to keep this respectability going for yourself and for your family. That, you know, particularly young women face it a lot, and they're constantly juggling this and are very frustrated by it. I mean, all the time.
In fact, I have this theory about living in Mumbai, because all of us live in these small apartments compared to, you know, when I worked in Delhi, I was amazed at the kind of personal space that you got. Is that you create space in your head. So basically, I think people living in Bombay know how to block out everything. And what your cover, in a sense, exemplifies this is all these couples who sit on Marine Drive facing out to the sea. And it's like, that's their little space. It doesn't matter who's walking behind them, who's saying that Chanawala is coming, somebody else is doing something. It doesn't matter. They have created their own space. And it's a kind of reflex way in which you survive in a city like this, where, and then people also don't look at each other as a result, you know, because everybody is conscious of the fact that we're all creating our little spaces. So compared to other cities where you have much more staring going on, you find in a city like Mumbai, because of the fact that, you know, anyway, people, there's no concept of personal space when you grow up in the city. That seems to have a part in the manner in which we use public space. Shilpa, Ranade.
Just to complete the loop of what we, this production of, you know, protection of reputation and production of respectability is also kind of related to a production of physical safety. Because for women, if something happens to them, right, if this whole question of who are you with, what were you doing, all that comes. And if you're seen as a good woman, you know, you're seen as a respectable woman, it's much more likely that you will kind of get support in a way, you know. So I think it is indirectly related to your production of safety. So it's, you know, so it is related to your material safety in that sense.
Yeah. There's a longish question here, which I'll try and read out from Asima Jenna. Recent feminist theorization on space has explained us that space is fluid, lived and embodied space, and importantly, complicated the understanding between public and private dichotomy by highlighting the strategic management of space, concrete practice, intersectionality, etc. immediate access on the line of right to city is poor migrant tribals making tiny space as their shelter and sleeping on the pavement. Secondly, women farmers drying paddy in the highways. Can you throw some insights on this? Shilpa Phatke, as you are the academic amongst us, okay. I'll ask you.
Yeah. I mean, clearly, I mean, the question you're asking raises questions of intersectionality. And this is something that we have tried to speak to in the book as well, to say that women are not a homogeneous group. And in fact, what our study did for us as well is to disrupt the notion that only women, only middle class or upper middle class women desire to have pleasure or fun in public space. But you're exactly right that there is a group of women. And though we didn't look so much at migrant farmers, or we didn't look at highways so much, we did do some interviews and quite a lot of ethnography amongst street dwellers, so people who live on footpaths on the street, and we would hang out there and we did a couple of interviews with them. And clearly there is a kind of flattening of the public and private space there, even more so than there is in slums, right? So the slum is a community and they have their network of streets, and even their part of their lives are led in the public, but there's a known network of neighbors and how you behave in that space. And for them, their own streets were an extension of their home, but other streets were sort of more threatening, where there were boys from other streets. And they're also sort of extrapolating from our earlier response. The boys on your street were in the nature of brothers to you, only so long as you behaved like a good girl. Of course, if you were a bad girl, then of course they policed you a great deal. But they would harass girls from other streets. They wouldn't harass you. That was left to boys from other streets who would harass you. But what you point to actually living on the street is a whole different kind of realm altogether, right? Because there often there are cars, there are vehicles, and that public is far more threatening, not just because of the people that are there, but also, and we know stories most famously about Salman Khan, about sleeping people getting mowed down by cars, you know? So there are multiple threats over there, and those spaces are deeply sort of, they are really in a different, these people are not in public. They don't live in the public because they choose to. They live there because they are forced to. And I think that's something that we do need to see as very, very separate from the other kinds of claims that we are making that women want. And these women in that sense were no exception, right? They also wanted to go to parks, but they don't want to live on the street. And I think that that's something that we should really be, and of course, again, different from women farmers who might be protesting on the highways outside Delhi, who are making a choice to be there and who have every right to be there because the Indian constitution does allow citizens to peacefully protest. I'm not sure I totally answered that question, but just sort of gesture to the realm in which it's located.
I mean, I think what your book lays out are many more areas that need to be, you know, further investigated. And this is obviously one of them. There's another interesting question from, I think, Gina Rotman. She says COVID-19 has sparked hierarchization of activities, spaces, businesses, and ways of being on the basis of what select groups deem essential. What do you think the long-term effects of such attitudinal as well as material shifts might be in the context of your work? For example, in terms of hesitancy to venture out, further limits on opening hours, the need to justify activity, etc. So I think that's an interesting question, as we've all been through this year, strange year that we have lived through, and it may be still another year at the rate at which things are going. Mm-hmm. Anyone?
Samira, you want to take that?
Yes.
Ah, Shilpa. Shilpa, you unmuted. Yeah.
Shilpa?
No, I'm unmuted. I thought Samira should take it. I think she has a better understanding of the...
Is she frozen? I think she's frozen.
Samira, did you hear the question?
No, I did. Huh. No, we are... No. So I'm not sure. I think someone can jump in as well. I think definitely we are very worried that the gains a lot of women have made into at least expressing a desire of public space and being in public space or fighting for it, or women at the front line, young women arguing for it on college campuses, on public space, that these rights now under name of, if now we're protecting not just from men, but from a virus, will be rescinded and taken away because now we're all indoors. And to now when I again want to go into public space, will I again have to put up a fight? Will I again have to raise issues? Because now they can have another argument. So in the name of this protectionism, protecting you from the virus, we all are now indoor. So I think we are worried that all the rights women have gained, or the nascent rights, we've just sort of just about, at least we're talking about them, we're expressing that need. We haven't got them all. That those rights will be now taken away immediately. And I worry particularly, for example, with real things, like if you're going to make girls drop out of school or college or higher education, a lot of young men who talk to us who are going to college, they express this much more than young men who go to college, that going to college, even whether I was not academically inclined or not, I mean, college was, education was away somewhere, but more than that, it gave me access to the world outside my home. It was a very legitimate way I could say I'm going and doing something productive, of course, but I'm also being able to meet my friends. I go for that tuition class to pass that exam because I also get to wander bits of the gullies. I began to hang out in my city, so being out. But the moment you take away this, and now all you say is education could be only online. Let's make it for women all online. And why would you go out? Because the family finances have been hit. You will not, the girls will not study. And already they're talking about education rates, girls dropping out of higher education or even schools. That's worrying because on one hand, it's about education. But on the other hand, it's about rights to the public and to access their city. A lot of young women are really worried about this. And I think we'll have to put up another fight. I mean, I think we have to really regroup and strategize. What does it mean for women if you cannot go out and work? Everybody says, ghar pe baithe, online kaam karo, ya online padhai karo. What does that mean? And this can easily be said that the men now, things are better, the virus is not there. The men can still go out. And women under the name of maybe family finances for your commuting, or why would you do it? Because now the pandemic behavior of this online learning, online work has shown us a new way that we can tell women you can stay at home and still be productive. And I think that is worrying. So we don't want that to be used as an excuse for not another new excuse of again protectionism.
Yeah, and I think the other aspect of it that has come out now with new data and studies coming out is, you know, women are stuck at home, basically, with COVID-19. And the issue of domestic violence, which is a huge one. It was called another pandemic already at the beginning of this pandemic. And now I think WHO has come out with another study which says one in three women around the world have experiences of domestic violence over this period when they're locked in with their abusers. And also child sexual abuse, I think, is another issue. So I think we will be studying for some time to come the impact of this year and what it has done, both conceptually and in actual fact, to the whole issue of women and women's access. We're running out of time, I think, but couple of other questions that I'll just flag.
Can I quickly add to this? We also saw that the pandemic was used as an excuse to shut down the protest sites and the sit-ins, and particularly in Shaheenbagh, which had become really an art space, an installation space. One of the other things they did other than shut down the protest is they painted over all of the walls, they painted over the murals, they took down the installations, they tried to erase all signs of protest. And I think that that's another thing we should flag.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think they tried to erase that whole involvement, which was in every way a historic one. This question, I think, is an important one, which Vanita Mukherjee has raised, which is linked to the earlier question about planning. In Mumbai Development Plan, Akshara, which is a group here in Mumbai, was a participant in the planning. And so she asks how important that was and whether that is something that, you know, is something that one can think of in the future. One should push for that, you know, maybe this time it may not have led to some dramatic changes, but generally in city planning, if there are groups that can be part of the development planning process, it's linked also to the earlier questions about how many women are. What do you think? I mean, is it enough that these groups, I mean, it's a beginning, obviously, but are they really heard in the way in which these planners think? Or do you think they are beginning to make a dent? I mean, Shilpa, Ranade?
Yeah, like I said, I think the fact that there was acknowledgement, one has to optimistically think that there has been a dent which has been made, right, by the by the involvement of Akshara and such groups in the thing. So, yeah. And it was kind of eventually watered down in the final plan, but I mean, the initial proposals were far more complex, which brought in all these kind of the invisible aspects of women's access to public space in a sense. So, yeah, I think, but like, I mean, the thing is that every time you discuss these things, what you realize is how much more needs to be done, right? Yeah. I mean, that you've done, but there is still a lot more that needs to be done in a way. And I think, and at every stage, like as designers, as occupants of space, and as people who use it as citizens, I think we cannot say that, yeah, we've achieved a milestone. There's a lot long way to go, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, so there are fights on different fronts. And I think this is very important inclusion of the gender in the DP plan. But we can't, you know, we hope that other cities who are putting up development plans take that idea from the Bombay DP, also implement it, and obviously keep it going. So the next DP has even more of it and more. And we have to keep fighting on other fronts. So I think it's an important move ahead, but we can't rest on alone. There's the tons of areas to be worked on in multiple cities, you know.
I think, and one important this thing to add, which also adds to the COVID question, what COVID brought to front is actually the amount of care labor that women do, right?
Yeah.
So it is an addition, you know, this idea that you ended up, you were working from home, and women who worked from home had to take care of a lot more than what they were doing other than the work. So I think, and it comes to planning also, one still thinks of more tangible things, like I mentioned, you know, about transit, and transit is more, know, public transport and so on and so forth. But this the kind of lopsided division of labor that we have also impacts women's use of public space in many ways, right? Also impacts how women use cities in ways. So I think that really needs to be brought in kind of inherently in our policies, I think. The understanding of that complexity in a way.
Yeah, in fact, you know, the majority of the frontline workers were in fact women, you know. The nurses and the others, and even the ASHA workers, who were not even acknowledged for a long time as frontline workers, and their exposure and the risks that they face, both in terms of contracting the disease, but there are stories of sexual harassment and them being, you know, the kind of things that they probably did not even talk about. You know, we don't know. Some of those stories will come out. I think we'll wind up. There is a question on the digital world, but the reason I'm not raising it is because I think that's a whole women, the space for women in the digital world and the risks they face, that's another discussion. So I think this has been, at least for me, always, it's been such a pleasure to talk to the three of you, and for the remarkable work that you've done and that you continue to do in different ways. And I will come back to what I said in the beginning, that if there are people here who have not read this book, do go out and order it and buy it. And I believe it's already prescribed reading in a number of courses. It ought to be in many more, because I think it's the kind of book that triggers these conversations that we've already had. And these conversations must continue at many different fora. It ought not to be restricted to only feminist groups, because this is mainstreaming the way in which women can be central to so many aspects of our lives and the way in which our cities are run. And I think by talking about the whole issue of risk and safety and access and right, you have brought that to the central, to the center of this kind of perspective that we need. So thank you, both the Shilpas and Samita. And thank you, Amita, very much for organizing this discussion. I hand it back to you for the evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Kalpana, Samira, Shilpa, and Shilpa. This was truly enriching and an engaging discourse. You see the chat box filled up with the kind of comments of what this particular discourse really did and is. And I agree that such discourses must continue. One can almost say, while you were very humble, all of you, 2011 is when the book came out, the concept of loitering and what have you. In 2012, when we did have this unfortunate incident of Delhi gang rape, that the women decided to be out there, and they are now right there. And I think your book has definitely triggered that movement of breaking out, Pinjra Tod as it is. But there are other little signs also that I think have come out, that big bag that you used to carry or a dupatta when you were outdoors physically, we have shed it over the last 10 years. And that is a very important feature which goes with the concept of lordship. So I think you all can take a bow that this book has really set a very major milestone of mobility for women and needs to continue to be, you know, part of a very active discourse. And clearly from everything that all of you have talked about, and Kalpana, thank you for raising very detailed issues, you know, very meticulously that come across in the book, but also part of our life today, going from Kashmir, Punjab to Bangalore. Clearly, the society's social fabric feels very threatened by women out there, dupatta-less, you know, maqsad-less out there on the streets with their own purpose in mind. And particularly our young women, I mean, to have a 22-year-old taken into custody absolutely shows that the women are out there, ready to stay there, along with all our dadis and whoever is threatened will have to deal with us. So this is a very important thing. Thank you so much. This was absolutely wonderful for all of us present here. Kalpana, for taking us through this discourse so beautifully. And thank you so much, Shilpa Phadke, Samira Khan, and Shilpa Ranade. Thank you for being with us. This is the 10th year. We will continue and we will call you in again. Thank you and have a great evening, all of you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gertha Zetron. Thank you, Amita. And thank you, Kalpana. Yeah. Yes. Kalpana has been an early interpreter of our work.
Kalpana has been an interlocutor from the beginning. So thank you so much, Kalpana, Amita, Gertha Zetron.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.